prostaglandin analogues. We're aware there's a whole bunch of them available now. They open the drain, but not through the regular drain. They open up the drain through the uveal scleral outflow. They work quite well, but they do have some local side effects that can be, depending on the patient, either desirable or bothersome. Conjunctival hyperemia, almost always bothersome. Iris color change, almost always bothersome. And it only happens in the pigmented areas. So if you've got somebody that has blue eyes and there's no pigment, they're going to stay blue. If you've got somebody that's got blue with brown spots, those spots are going to become more noticeable. Hazel eyes become more brown. If you've got somebody with a dark brown iris, it's not going to matter. Lash growth, most people appreciate that. Although some of the prostaglandins do tend, at least under the slit lamp, to provide more of a spidery, unruly lash growth, which isn't always appreciated. And men don't always appreciate it. The other thing we've been seeing recently is prostaglandin-associated periorbitopathy. That's a mouthful. Which is essentially a reduction of the tissue around the eye. Now, early on, again, it can be rather desirable, right? So you've got somebody with some excess bags under the eyes, you apply the prostaglandins, things seem to tighten up a little bit. It's like they've had a little laser surgery tightening, or sometimes it even looks like they've had a lower lid left. That's great early on, but if it progresses too far, it can actually tighten the lid so much that it's difficult to obtain a pressure measurement using Goldman applanation tonometry. So this can actually get in the way of your ability to monitor glaucoma. Now, there's some other things. You can get intraocular inflammation. This is a bit controversial, but the prostaglandins are part of the inflammatory cascade. So it makes perfect sense that they are pro-inflammatory. And indeed, there's evidence that they can increase the risk of macular edema, at least in those patients who are already at risk for macular edema. Herpes virus reactivation can be an issue, so you should generally not use this particular drop to lower the pressure in somebody who has a history of herpes virus infection, at least of the eye. And then headaches. There have been reports of pretty severe nocturnal headaches. Speaking of headaches, the cholinergic receptors, pilocarpine. What's the one thing we all think about with pilocarpine is headache. Now, these are still around because they can still be quite useful in those of our patients with narrow angles, but they're also still worth being aware of, just in terms of general practice, because they do work pretty well. They open the drain through a different mechanism than the ones we've talked about. Essentially, they provide some tension on the posterior trabecular meshwork and allow increased outflow. Okay. But brow ache, poor night vision due to the meiosis, induced myopia, and then there are these other issues. Retinal detachment, more of an issue with high myopes. But of course, if you've got a retinal detachment and somebody who has a small pupil that you can't dilate, that's an issue, right? And then less likely, but something that was more commonly seen with the older agents in this class, and also when we were using this drop a lot more, cicatricial conjunctival pemphigoid, corneal endothelial toxicity. So it's not just the carbonic anhydrase inhibitors that can give you issues with the corneal endothelium, it's also pilocarpine, and then band keratopathy. Fortunately, we now have these fixed combination agents. We have three of them here in the U.S., COSOP, timolol plus dorzolamide, Combigan, which is timolol plus spironolamide, and Simbrinza, which is spironolamide plus spironolamide. My current favorite is Simbrinza, simply because it doesn't have the timolol component. Now, the other thing to keep in mind here is that these agents, COSOPT and Combigan, the two that are fixed combination agents which do have timolol in them, you're using these twice a day. Okay? It's a twice a day agent where you're using timolol twice a day, which really is best used once a day in the morning, because the nighttime dose doesn't really help you all that much in terms of the aqueous production, which drops at night anyway. But the other thing is, we now know that using beta blockers at night can potentially put patients at risk for what's called dipping, which is where their blood pressure drops by 10 points. Patients who dip are at a much, much higher risk of progression with their glaucoma. So why in the world would you want to use a drop that places a beta blocker in the eye that then moves systemically in most patients at night? Now the other issue here is we're dosing these twice a day, Cosopt and Combigan. Well, dorzolamide and brimonidine both work best three times a day. So the Cosopt and Combigan I've almost entirely eliminated from my practice because in my mind, these are just bad compromises, right? You're not getting the right dosing on the brimonidine and the dorzolamide, and you're getting too much timolol and potentially actually putting your patient at risk if they're a dipper. Now, if you're worried about dipping, you can get a 24-hour blood pressure monitoring. It's not that expensive. It's not that much of a hassle. Generally, you work with the internist. Most internists are happy to do it because it's information they'd like anyway. But for that reason, I've really moved to Simbrinza, recommending it three times a day. If patients don't get that middle of the day dose, I tell them don't feel guilty about it. Just try to do it. Right? We've all got more guilt than we need. So